Libraries are free. Disneyland costs $100 and has more customers. Well, my favorite American writer, Mark Twain, said, "It's much easier to fool people than it is to convince them that they have been fooled." Well, tonight, we're going to try to unfool you, because if you've been listening to the American media, and if you've been listening to our government for 50 years, you have indeed been fooled. And to help rectify that are three of the very best in this field. You saw the man to my left, Jim Maher, is one of the great investigative journalists without whom I could have not made this documentary. He was invaluable in the information that he imparted. He has new information. He's the author of a great book about the case called Crossfire, which was the basis of the film that Oliver Stone made called JFK, the other book that was used with Jim Garrison's book. And with the earnings that Jim got, he bought a hat, which I'm glad to see. And next to Jim from Temple University, she teaches a course on the assassination. She teaches creative writing. And she's the definitive biographer of Jim Garrison, with a classic book that's just been renewed with updated information. And it's called A Farewell to Justice. Ladies and gentlemen, Joan Mellon. And then to Joan's left, a man who I've known and admired for a number of years. He's a very Catholic writer with a small c, in that he writes about everything. He is the man who really writes Jesse Ventura's bestsellers. It was on the bestseller list for 2 weeks, the New York Times bestseller list. The man, they killed our president. He's also the author of a really classic 700-page book called The Man Who Knew Too Much. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Dick Russell. I was going to address, and I'm going to address my first question to Joan Mellon, since she is Jim's official biographer. But before I do, she asked me a question earlier in the rehearsal about whether or not Jim ever saw the film. Well, Jim saw the film on his deathbed, and he absolutely loved the film. And the day it was awarded the San Sebastian Film Festival Award, he died. But I'm going to tell you a story that nobody knows about Jim that'll tell you, you've seen what kind of man he is, what kind of heart he had, what kind of wit he had, is that you saw in the documentary that the stress of this caused a divorce. His wife's name was Liz. She just could not take it anymore, and she divorced. And like a lot of women who divorce, she rebounded and married a fellow that spent all her money. And she got to be in her mid-50s, and she had no money. And Jim Garrison was on his deathbed. And he called his daughter, Liz, and he said, "Liz, I want you to get my ex-wife over here. I want you to get the minister over here, okay?" And the daughter said, "Why?" He said, don't bother me. Just get the kids and get them over here, okay? I don't have much time." So they got a preacher, and they got a marriage license. And Liz came over and said, "Jim, I've already married you once. I don't want to go through it again." He says, "Honey, you're not going to have to go through it long. I'm not going to be here a long time, okay? You're going to marry me right now." And they got married. And you know why? Because he knew when he died, she would get the pension. Anyway, that's the kind of man he was. Joan, how did you happen to meet Jim for the first time? And is there any information that you've come across that, if he had access to during the Clay Shaw trial, could have convicted Clay Shaw?
All right. So much to say. I want to talk a little bit first about the importance of John Barber's film. And that is that what we are all interested now in is what's happening to our country, why we're in Afghanistan, why we're in Iraq, why are we having a drone base in Afghanistan to the point that CIA demands that we keep troops in Afghanistan to guard the base where the drones are taking off from. What is going on here? And when we look at this film, we should look through what Jim Garrison was telling us and what John has recorded, and no one else has recorded. There's no other film like this, including JFK. And that shows exactly what Jim Garrison's thinking. He looks at Oswald. He sees Oswald in the summer of 1963, and he says, this man not only, based on what the Warren report, by the way, there are things that I could tell you about Jim Garrison that would illuminate the film and change some of the things about the film. One is that it wasn't Russell Long who brought Jim Garrison to the case. Take a guess who it was, folks. Who was he protecting by giving it to Russell Long? Hale Boggs, of course, because Hale Boggs was on the Warren Commission, and he was talking out of school. And Alan Dulles had told everyone in those executive sessions, not a word out of here.
But what happened to Hale Boggs?
Exactly. Hale Boggs disappears in an airplane over Alaska, and there's never no wreckage. And you, right, is that true? No wreckage, nothing.
Yeah. They never found the plane.
And they never found anything. And he had just attacked Hoover on the floor of the House. And then this, and so this is what happens. And Jim, so it really shows, and this film records, the enormous courage of Jim Garrison, which also includes the courage of John Barber in making a film about this person who to this day his name is taboo. And if you go on cable TV and you go on any TV, and including Al Jazeera TV, you don't hear the name Jim Garrison even at the 50th anniversary of the Kennedy assassination. What got me started on this, I beat John by a year, and that is I met Jim Garrison in 1969. And he invited me and my husband to New Orleans because my husband had been living in London and had gotten the series of newspaper articles from an Italian newspaper of the left, which Richard Helms lied and said was taking orders from the KGB. It wasn't true. They're the independent Italian left. And they had a series on an organization called Permindex, which had an office in Italy called, my Italian is no good, Centro Mondiale Commerciale. And the article mentioned Clay Shaw, and how interesting that only a few weeks ago he was indicted in New Orleans by Jim Garrison. And it said that he was with CIA. And of course, the person who recruited Shaw to that was Ferenc Nagy. And if you look in the National Archives, and good luck if you can find this document still, because they remove documents all the time, but the Frank Wisner papers show that Nagy was a CIA asset since right after World War II. And from the East European section. Somebody once asked me, where are these Wisner papers and that really tell us what the early CIA was like? Good luck. I managed, somebody got them, and then you have to practically be associated with an intelligence service, maybe of this country, maybe of another, to get these documents. So anyway, but I got it. So now so Jim Garrison invites us to New Orleans to thank Ralph for having sent him the Paese Sera articles. He could not use them in court because newspaper clippings are hearsay, and he couldn't go to, he didn't have the money. One of the things we need, you know, he was doing this whole investigation on a shoestring, and he had nothing, and so he couldn't go to Italy and start investigating, and so he could not use those Paese Sera articles. In his book, he misremembers, Garrison misremembers, and he says, I only got those articles after the Shaw trial. No, he had them in March of 1967.
Do you remember the name that he gave the group that was financing him to investigate the case?
God, now this is Cecil Shillstone, Willard Robert.
The guy that owned the...
Help me out. The Willard Robertson who had the VW dealership.
That's right. And they called the group...
Truth or Consequences.
Truth or Consequences. And do you recall what his code name was? From 1984, he gave himself a code name.
Winston Smith.
Yes.
And that is, Garrison actually gave the name Winston Smith to one of the people that was doing investigating for him called Jim Rose, or sometimes called Carl McNabb, was a CIA contract pilot and knew David Ferry when they flew together. Another thing about Garrison that we could add, enormously literary. He had a set of Shakespeare on his desk. He didn't like the Greek classics. He preferred Shakespeare.
He wanted to be a writer, didn't he?
He wanted to be a writer, and he sold more than two copies of A Heritage of Stone. John was joking, of course, about that. He sold a lot. We went into several printings. He also got a $250,000 advance for the Star Spangled contract, which Ralph actually sold it for him. And Ralph said, I don't want a commission. I'm not a literary agent. Jim said, I won't take the money unless you take the 10%. He didn't care about money. He didn't have a dime in his pocket. He couldn't afford to send his children to college. They had to work their way through as waiters and all of this, and he had nothing. So the idea that he took bribes from pinball operators or anybody else, or that he was in friendly with Carlos Marcello because he was getting something from the mafia, all part of the disinformation campaign that CIA began the minute he started his investigation.
Do you remember what happened to some of the money that was raised when Rose went to Miami and was interviewed on the Larry King show? See, one of the reasons is
Jim... lots of stories.
Yeah, okay. One of the reasons that Jim didn't use the money from the treasury of his office is that the public had access to that, and he didn't want anybody to know he was conducting this investigation. And this terrific group of substantial businessmen were financing him in New Orleans because he felt he had the truth. One of them was interviewed in the Larry King
Lewis
show.
Lewis Wolfson. I don't know if that name means you like racehorses. He had a Triple Crown winner. I think it was called Affirmed. Correct me. Is that the horse? Lewis Wolfson, just a second.
Okay.
Lewis Wolfson gave the money, but he didn't want to be known because he was trying to get a pardon. He had some financial skullduggery, and he didn't want his name known that he was giving money to Jim Garrison, so there was going to be an intermediary. And that intermediary was a person you also know, Larry King, who used to be on CNN running an interview show. Larry King stole the money instead of bringing it to Jim Garrison. And a great person who is in my book called Martin F. Dardis, who really broke the Watergate case. That's another whole story. And he's in the film All the President's
Men. Well, yeah,
Men.
But why did Larry steal the money?
Why did he was a thief? Larry
No. You said that Wolfson had a Triple Crown winner. Larry King was a bad horse player. And he stole the $50,000 and paid the $50,000 to bookies, but he was only convicted of stealing $5,000.
Well, that's right. Very good point.
Okay.
Because just for the court, they settled that it was going to be $5,000. It was, of course, much more than that. And then the interesting thing here in Garrison's character is that when the press finally realized what had happened, and Marty said, the bills are marked, these are not the same bills, because Richard Gerstein, who was the state's attorney in Miami-Dade, tried to lie for King. And so Martin's... he was a great money trail guy, which is how he got the CREEP Nixon stuff and how he broke Watergate. You might know Marty because, every reporter who knows anything about Miami knew Martin F. Dardis.
Okay, Joe.
Wait, I can't stop. Just a minute.
Okay.
I lost my train of thought.
I'm sorry. We'll get back to it. Hang on. Just put it on pause for a second.
Because we still want to talk about how Garrison's case was validated.
Yeah,
but maybe you want to hear from Dick first?
No, because I want to first know how... about Jim and how he felt looking at himself 20 years ago.
Oh,
I mean, he really looked terrific.
He looked great.
But
I don't know what happened to my hair.
I heard you a month or two ago on the Jeff Rentz internet show, and you brought up the name of a woman who was supposedly a cashier at the book depository who was giving change to Lee at the time. Could you tell that story?
Okay, but I need to make this quick because I have now dug into that. Any of y'all know what we're talking about the possibility of two Mrs. Reeds? Well, I don't think so. I think this is a non-story. I have right here, if you want to come look at it, her handwritten statement from the next day, from November the 23rd.
Who was she?
She was a secretary at the school book depository.
Uh-huh.
And she married her name was Geraldine Reed. And when she married Robert A. Reed, she became Mrs. Robert A. Reed. The Dallas Police Intelligence Chief, Lieutenant Jack Revel, left the school book depository and went right back to the city hall where he met James Hostey. I think you all know about that story. And then he went up to his office and he typed up the list of all the school book depository employees. Heading the list was Harvey Lee Oswald of 605 Elsmith, which, as you heard in the documentary there, then was the same two mistakes that were found in military intelligence files, which means they were tipping off the Dallas police to their suspect. But on his list of the school book depositories, interestingly enough, there's two Mrs. Reeds. There's a Mrs. Robert A. Reed on page one, and on page two, there's a Mrs. R. A. Reed. But they both have the same Elmwood address. So I think it's the same person. Now, the only thing that came up with the two Mrs. Reeds is that there is a statement in the Warren Commission volumes from a Pauline Sanders, who said that day she called her friend Geraldine Reed, and Geraldine Reed told her that about the confrontation between Oswald and the Dallas policeman Marion Baker and truly the building superintendent, and that a few minutes later he had come through her office holding a Coca-Cola, and that she said, oh, the president has been shot, I hope he's not hit. And she said Oswald mumbled something, but she couldn't understand what he said as he walked on towards the entrance of the building. That's the exact same thing that Mrs. Robert A. Reed, if you go read her testimony, it's the exact same thing. Now, here's, I think, where the confusion came. Pauline Sanders says, my friend Geraldine Reed. Well, the FBI report put down G-E-R-A-L-D-I-N-E, the conventional spelling of Geraldine. Mrs. Robert A. Reed, Geraldine Reed, spelled it J-E-R-A-L-D-E-A-N. And I've got her birth records, census records from 1940, and I've got her death certificate and signed off on by her husband, Robert A. Reed. So,
and she was present with Oswald at the time of the shot?
No.
Oh, I thought you
no,
said on
that. Robert Groden has put that into his latest book, and that's where it got started.
Oh, I see.
And I was talking to Robert just the other day, and I said, is it possible that you actually talked to Mrs. Robert A. Reed, but you only knew her as Geraldine Reed? And he said, yeah, that's possible. So I think there's just been a mix-up there.
Oh, I'm glad you clarified that. Dick, the man who knew too much, a lot of people have never heard of Richard Case Nagel. Could you tell very quickly the audience the story of Richard and why he did what he did?
Yeah, it's a long and complicated story, but I'll try to summarize it. And that's the reason I went to see Jim Garrison in 75 and then again in 76, was to talk about Richard Nagel, who Garrison told me he thought was the most important living witness that there was. And I had met him in 1975. Nagel had been arrested. He sometimes pronounced it both ways, Nagel. It's spelled with two L's at the end, but at any rate, he had been arrested in September 20th, 1963, 2 months and 2 days before the assassination, outside a bank in El Paso, Texas. He'd walked in, he'd asked a teller for $100 in American Express traveler's checks, he'd stood back and fired two shots into the ceiling and walked outside and intentionally gotten himself arrested. The FBI, he did this because he wanted to be taken into federal custody. The FBI, he said, why don't you look in my trunk? There's a machine gun in there. He had a couple notebooks on him. One of those notebooks, the reason I found Nagel so interesting and wanted to find him in 75 when I was starting to freelance about the assassination for a number of newspapers, The Village Voice, Harper's Weekly among them. And one of these notebooks had contained remarkably similar listings to Oswald's. The Fair Play for Cuba Committee was in there. The number of the Cuban embassy in Mexico City was in there. And I saw this notebook. I mean, the FBI held on to it for 12 years, finally released it in 1975 to Bernard Fensterwall, Jr., an attorney in Washington. And I'd seen it, and I tracked Nagel down in Los Angeles, knocked on his door, and struck up a relationship with him that went on casually. I mean, I saw him maybe once every 6 months. I ended up going to work out in L.A. for TV Guide magazine for a few years. So I waited for a long, long time to tell what I knew of his story, and I never got the entire story from him. But I saw enough, not just the notebook, but other things, to make me believe that this guy was totally credible. And I interviewed a lot of people about the assassination. And Garrison certainly thought he was very credible. The unfortunate thing about Garrison's investigation, Nagel was, well, he was railroaded through prison for 4.5 years and tried twice and convicted twice in El Paso of, quote, attempted bank robbery. I talked to a lot of people in El Paso who knew that was a bogus deal, of course, too. He tried to bring out issues about this before the court, was prevented from doing so. The judge who came into his trial suddenly in January of 64 was a very, very close friend of Lyndon Johnson's named Homer Thornberry, who totally squelched anything about the assassination from coming up at the trial. At any rate, Nagel was in prison in Leavenworth in Springfield, Illinois, when Garrison first heard about him and sent a guy who'd come onto his staff named William R. Martin to interview Nigel in prison and find out what he could. Martin, it turned out, worked for the CIA, and certainly formerly had been in the Latin American division and still was. He was one of a number of agents who were infiltrating garrison staff, and that's been well documented in recent years. The Nigel story, very quickly, of what he knew, or what I found out he knew, was that he'd been involved in monitoring a plot that had come to involve Oswald only in the summer of 63. Before that, there had been two earlier plans to assassinate President Kennedy, one in Miami in December of 62, another in L.A., when the premiere of the movie PT-109 was going to happen in June of 63. And then Oswald was brought in as the key patsy by some anti-Castro Cuban exiles and renegade CIA people because, of course, Oswald had been in Russia and they had this whole thing. He was going to go to Mexico and try to get into Cuba. And exactly what Oswald's role was always unclear in terms of what Nigel was willing to tell me. There was a photograph of Oswald and Nigel taken in Jackson Square, New Orleans, in the summer of 63, which has never surfaced. Nigel was assigned, he was a double agent, he was assigned by the Russians. He'd been put to work by the CIA to penetrate the Russian KGB or GRU, and the Russians had assigned Nigel to keep an eye on this guy, Oswald, and also to monitor this assassination plot. And that had been going on for some months. At any rate, it was the Russians who ordered Nigel in the summer of 63 to either convince Oswald he was being set up, or if he couldn't do that, kill him in Mexico City. Rather than do that, Nigel sent a warning letter to J. Edgar Hoover, giving him plenty of information about what was going down, also warned his superiors in the CIA, Desmond Fitzgerald among them. And long story very short, walked into that bank in El Paso and intentionally got himself taken out of the picture.
I saw you nodding a lot when Dick was talking.
I wanted to say one thing, and that is that Jim Garrison finally, Dick knows this, of course, did ask Richard Case Nagel to come and testify at the Shaw trial. And Nagel said he will testify, however, he will not use the word CIA. And when Garrison heard that, that was what's the point? Who needs him if he isn't able to reveal the part that he played and that Oswald played in relation to CIA? And so that's really, we would have gone there, but he wouldn't have said CIA. I just want to say one thing. I'm looking at the emails and things because John wanted me to say this for starters, and I've said it before, but I wanted to just say, and I have copies of this document if you need it. Some people have said, well, Jim Garrison's case had a lot of holes in it, and why is there so much animosity toward Jim Garrison, which I can answer easily with, because the CIA media assets that were set out in 1967 against Garrison are still out there and still working against Garrison. And the other thing is that, even though I've said this before, repeat it because it's the best document that I ever had, which is that the History Review Group of CIA was working on the issue of what to do with the House Select Committee records that CIA had created to giving to the House Select Committee. What are they going to give it to the National Archives? Are they going to keep it secret till 2029? Whatever. And in the course of that document, the CIA refers to an extraordinary fact, which is that they had Office of Security files on Clay Shaw. And that now that's very different from the clandestine services. Garrison and John Barber, they've made us look at the CIA and look at this agency and its role in American power and in how this country is run. And that's our purpose here, is to do that. But wait, I didn't get to the punchline yet.
Okay.
Hold on. And that is that the punchline of that document is, they write, and it's an internal document now, it's not for disinformation, for external use, for whatever. It says Clay Shaw was a highly paid CIA contract source. And Garrison never had that. If he had anything like that, he might have made the attempt to assign motivation to Shaw for the jury in that trial in New Orleans. He had no motive. He couldn't give motivation. And so what did he do? Shaw had a very slick lawyer who said, have you ever been associated with CIA? Have you ever worked for CIA? And Shaw just says, no, never. And that's the only introduction of CIA into the Shaw trial is from the side of the defense, Clay Shaw's side. And here we have, and this is only one record. The one I have, that's an outstanding record. But there are other evidence that has come across since the Garrison case, and since my book first came out. And one is, and I won't go into all the details now, you'll die. But that is that James Angleton had told the Church Committee, no, Oswald was never debriefed by CIA when he returned from the Soviet Union, and we have pretty good proof that Oswald, in fact, was debriefed by the Soviet-Russia division of CIA in New York City by a woman named Eleanor Reed. And so I just want to just throw that out.
The Church Committee in the 70s conducted hearings into the CIA, and at that time they revealed 1,000 CIA assets working in all American media, television, newspapers, radios, magazines, everything. That was in the 70s when they wanted to keep the Vietnam War going.
I'd like to say, because this is important too, besides Clay Shaw, the importance of David Ferry, who never lived to be brought to trial or to be part of this.
Nor his roommate.
Well, that's what I want to talk about.
Okay.
Ferry's roommate was a guy named Raymond Brochiers, who I went to interview in 1975 in San Francisco, where he was a gay activist. He was had an organization there called Helping Hands. I spent some time with him one day. He didn't know I was coming, so I kind of surprised him, and he was very nervous and didn't know if he wanted to talk or not. But Garrison had interviewed him, but he never became part of the Clay Shaw trial. But what he told me was that before David Ferry died, Ferry had called him and said, they're going to kill me, I'm going to be killed. The suicide note was bogus. And that what Ferry had told him was that he had been, you know, in the film there's the story of how he leaves, he goes in a rainstorm, he leaves the trial actually of Carlos Marcello, where he was an investigator for the head of the New Orleans mob. He leaves that trial. Marcello was, by the way, acquitted on the very same day that John Kennedy was killed later that day. And Ferry takes off in a driving rainstorm and goes to Galveston, Texas, where he's seen pumping, I guess it was nickels at that point, one after another into a payphone booth. And what Ferry told Brochiers was that he had gone there. Ferry was a pilot, and he had gone to Texas to fly the assassins out. And he was going to fly a twin-engine plane, and he got word in that phone booth that the plane, which he was going to fly to Mexico, and then the assassins were going to be taken on to South Africa, that the plane had gone down, that it had taken off earlier, apparently from Redbird Airport in Dallas, and was gone. And so what Brochiers said was that this was Ferry's role, that he had known Oswald. He had Oswald's library card on him at the time of the assassination, was very worried this would be found out. And Brochiers' final comment to me was that this was the assassination was a conspiracy and manipulated very cleverly the people involved by people pulling the strings. So these are the kinds of things that David Ferry knew, and the tragedy is, of course, that he was never around to take part in what Garrison was trying to do.
I just want to say one thing about Brochiers. Garrison had all the statements from Brochiers long, and he didn't use any of it, and he didn't have them in the trial. And the reason is that Garrison decided that he would, the two categories of people that he did not want to testify for the state, and one was homosexual, and that is he did not want to bring Shaw's homosexuality into the trial or mention it in any way or have any homosexual witnesses to come on behalf of the state's case. And so that's the other category and I think he regretted later, he didn't have anybody with a criminal record either, but then he finally realized, well, of course, who are you going to have who's been in on these things if not people that have a criminal record? It was a mistake. But those are the two categories, and he is scrupulous. Now, Bill Alford here is all caught up in the whips and the chains and the things that they found in Shaw's house on the night that Shaw was arrested by the Orleans Parish District Attorney's Office. But Garrison never publicly said anything about any of that.
It just shows you what a decent man is. He refused to prosecute a bookseller who was selling James Baldwin's book, The Fire Next Time, because he said it's a freedom
of
the press.
Another country.
Now, we'd like to, I see some hands up.
Yes,
yes sir. Would you stand? Give us your name and your question.
John Delaberta. The first question I had was, do you have any idea who the shooters were?
One shooter that I have in the Garrison case was named Lawrence Howard. And we know that he was at Dealey Plaza. We know that a set of documents, of diagrams and maps of the parade route were given to him the week before of the assassination. And he was a very famous sniper. And he was interviewed by L.J. Delsa, representing the House Select Committee on Assassinations, Louisiana group. And L.J. realized that he had no reason to tell the truth because nothing was ever going to happen. And so he found Lawrence Howard, which is a miracle no one else has. But he couldn't get him to say anything. That was one. That's only one. But that's one I'm pretty confident in. But why do you? What Jim? I want to say something. Jim Garrison only wanted to know. He didn't care who the shooters were. What he wanted to know was who planned the crime. He did not care. He kept saying, "I don't care about the shooters. I don't care about the shooters."
Now let me jump in there because I want to add to that. One of the biggest criticisms against Jim Garrison was the fact that they said, "Well, he's going soft on the mafia. He's not going after Carlos Marcello. He must be in Marcello's pocket or whatever." So, you know, I had an opportunity to have lunch with Garrison one time. And first off, I was expecting another bombastic, you know, self-important politician. And I found a very urbane and intelligent and educated person with a real knowledge and love of classical literature and all like that. Very thoughtful. But I asked him point blank. I said, you know, they say that you keep talking about the CIA, but what about the mafia? And he told me to my face, he said, "I can accept that the mafia was involved." He said, "But they didn't cover it up. They didn't appoint the Warren Commission. They didn't alter FBI reports." And folks, that's the thing you've got to keep in mind. We could be here till this time next week arguing over how many shots and where the assassins were and who they might have been, all like that. In my book, my new updated Crossfire, I've got, I think, four pretty good candidates for Grassy Knoll gunmen. But that's not the point. The point is the truth has been covered up, and it's been covered up at the level of the federal government. Okay? And when I say cover up, it goes beyond that. Federal officials committed alteration of evidence, destruction of evidence, fabrication of evidence, suppression of evidence, and intimidation of witnesses. These are criminal acts. Right. If you and I did that in connection with a murder case, it'd throw us in jail. And this happened at the federal level. This is what makes what at that time was simply a Texas homicide, and it makes it a national coup d'etat.
We tease the fact that somebody, if it was a conspiracy, had to tell Ruby to shoot Oswald. Jim Garrison gave me all of that information and much, much more. As a matter of fact, he wanted me to go to see Richard Nagel in prison. He said, "And bring him a Real People T-shirt, and he'll tell you the story of what happened." Dan, would you roll that very brief film about Garrison's observations about Ruby? On live television, the world saw the alleged assassin, the one man who could truly shed the most light on the murder of President Kennedy, gunned down while surrounded by Dallas police. The shooter, Jack Ruby, following his trial, pleaded with Chief Justice Earl Warren to be taken to Washington, where he said he'd feel safe enough to tell his story. Warren turned him down. Subsequently, columnist Dorothy Kilgallen was able to obtain an exclusive interview with Ruby, following which she said she was going to blow this case wide open. Days later, Dorothy Kilgallen was found dead, ruled an apparent accidental overdose. In the 9 months of the Warren Commission hearings, the one obvious question that went unasked by any member of that commission or any member of the press, a question maybe known to Dorothy Kilgallen, was who ordered Ruby to shoot Oswald. In his investigation, Jim Garrison did ask that question. And how Garrison tracked down who he thought might have given those orders was the result of simple, basic, common-sense CSI detective work that anyone seeking the truth might have employed. Not only did the commission not employ it, they tried to obscure it. What Garrison did was obtain phone records of the people who he was investigating. He found out that from September till November, David Ferry and Jack Ruby from different cities were making phone calls to this Chicago number, Whitehall 44970, and a room registered to a Miss Assey. In plowing through the Warren Report, Garrison found that the commission had changed her name from Assey to Jean West. Garrison then discovered that this lady, whatever her name, had testified that she'd accompanied a married businessman to Dallas. They went to Ruby's Carousel Club 2 days before the assassination, met Ruby, then after the assassination, moved to another motel, and on Saturday, hours after the assassination, her date met with Jack Ruby at the Cabana Hotel. Her date's name was Lawrence V. Myers, whose son, also in Dallas at the time, was with military intelligence. Federal officials prevented Garrison from ever interviewing Lawrence V. Myers.
That goes right back to your observation, Jim, that an ordinary, what was classified as an ordinary murder. The reason Garrison said that they would never extradite Myers is because there was no federal crime to killing the President of the United States. Uh-huh.
Well, and you know, the conventional wisdom of the time was that, well, you know, Oswald must have killed the president because he killed that policeman, J.D. Tippit. Except, I'm here to tell you folks, he did not kill Officer Tippit. How do I know this? Because I've talked to three separate witnesses, including Butch Burroughs, the assistant manager of the Texas Theater, who all said that they encountered Oswald in the theater at the time or before Officer Tippit was shot. So if there had ever been a fair trial and you've got three separate witnesses coming in and saying, well, you know, he was in the theater, he couldn't have shot the cop, he would have walked. They were not grooming him to kill the president or anything having to do. Nobody thought Kennedy was going to be president way back there. What they were doing is, between the time of the Russian Revolution, the communists were infiltrating all kinds of people into this country. They had spies everywhere, you know, Red Scare, the whole thing. We had not really done that. In fact, at the time of World War II, they were our allies. And then all of a sudden we had the Cold War. All right, they've got agents all over the United States. We had virtually nothing to know what was going on in Russia. So they began to groom some of these kids to fill in. So they had a kid in New York, and he could maybe even speak Russian. And his parents were refugees. They were anti-communist. He'd be a perfect asset. But they couldn't put him in there under his own name because the Russians would immediately know he's just a spy. So they went, hunted all through their records, and found a kid that looked a whole lot like him, Lee Harvey Oswald. And they recruited him into U.S. intelligence exactly as his mother always told me.
Now I have another problem because there's a document that came out of the House Select Committee Times which has all the different aliases of Oswald and Lee Harvey Henry. And next to Lee Henry, there's a T, and it means a true name.
You and John and Joan and Dick and literally hundreds of other unbelievably talented, capable people have come up with this information that is rock solid. So what is wrong with America that we can't get it solved and move it forward? Go ahead, Dick.
One thing, of course, big problem is the media. I mean,
amen. That's where I come from, and I'm ashamed of it.
Yeah. You know, now they're more controlled maybe than they were then. But back then, Bob Woodward did a piece for the, Carl Bernstein did a piece for the Rolling Stone back in the 70s about how the CIA had worked very astutely to infiltrate the media starting as soon as they were formed. In 1947, and just many, many examples of this. And C.D. Jackson, the publisher of Life magazine, very close to Alan Dulles, had worked for the CIA in the 50s, so it's no wonder that Life magazine is portraying Oswald as the lone assassin right from the beginning and buying the Zapruder film. CBS News, also highly infiltrated by the CIA, infiltrated, or at least that's really not the word. They were willingly cooperating with the CIA for many, many years. And, you know, so after all this time, 50 years go by, and you still watch everything basically defending the Warren Commission. And the reason is that after all this time that they've got so much egg on their face, They don't want to give any credibility to a book by Jim or Joan or John's film, because then, you know, they look like fools, which they are. But they had their own reasons, because they were very big establishment players, quote unquote.
Big salaries.
They're making money on these wars.
If
you really look into it and say, yes, the president was killed by a conspiracy, and it was a domestic conspiracy, and it was a coup d'etat, what does that do to our country? That means, hey, we better wake up.
Do any of you think that somebody from the CIA or the FBI was with Dan Rather when he saw the Zapruder film? Now, he goes from being a street reporter, he goes on the local news.
Well, you made the point in your own film. Bill Paley was with CIA, and yeah. and CBS is doing what CIA
yeah,
wants to do.
Yeah, but in Dan's autobiography, he said literally, it was a forgetful moment. Now, if you watch originally what he's saying, he describes in detail everything that John Kennedy's wearing, the pillbox hat, the color of Jackie's suit, the
movement of the motorcade,
movement of everything.
Everything's accurate.
Until the headshot that any idiot can see throws the president back like this, and he says he's thrown forward, and then a year later he's an anchor person. Making $6 million. They call him the $6 million man on CBS.
There's always a good lie always has a lot of truth in it, and the true details.
And in his autobiography was the camera never blinks. So when they ask him about, why did you say his head went forward and went back, he said, I must have blinked.
There are just hundreds and hundreds of messages here on the screen that are being tweeted in and Facebooked in it, and haven't had a chance to get to them. So let's try to get to a couple of them. Carolyn Roy's Goda, and she's in Missouri, says, hi guys, wish I was there. Two questions. Okay, please have each panelist address the nine and their relationship to this coup, i.e. Bell Helicopter, Ruth Fain, etc. What does that mean?
What is the nine?
The nine is, that's the hotel room down in Houston where all the big high rollers were, all the people. This would get into too much minutiae. It would run, y'all would go off to sleep. Basically, though, the point is that these were the oil people who were fueling the war machine. Texas was benefited from the Vietnam War. Dallas had Dallas-Fort Worth. Fort Worth had General Dynamics, and Dallas had Ling Timco Vault and Texas Instruments and all of these. Okay, and not to mention, not to lose sight of the fact that Brown and Root Construction of Houston put Lyndon Johnson in office back in the 30s to salvage one of their dam project that they had sunk a bunch of money into and then looked like they were going to lose the government contract. And he got it back for him. He was their fair-haired boy. And then when Vietnam came along, it was Brown and Root that built those runways. They practically built Cameron Bay. All right. And so this was the payoff. Now, you want to know how Johnson got the payoff from all these guys? Because I used to go out to the air shows at Greater Southwest Airport. It was an airport that Dallas had Love Field and Fort Worth had Meacham Field, and everybody understood that we needed a regional airport. We needed a big airport that would serve both Dallas and Fort Worth. So they created Greater Southwest Airport. Well, the problem was Amon Carter, the mover and shaker from Fort Worth, had a little more pull in Washington, and they got the terminal placed on the Tarrant County side. So Tarrant County was getting the bulk of the revenues, and Dallas got mad and pulled out. And to this day, they operate out of Love Field. Okay, so then in the late 60s, all of a sudden, the guy from Brown and Root came up there and started buying up all this property north of Greater Southwest Airport. And the next thing you know, it ended up in Lady Bird Johnson's name. And then they announced they were going to build Dallas-Fort Worth Regional Airport, and the land values went through the roof, and Johnson became a multimillionaire.
There have been two books out that say that Lyndon Johnson was behind the assassination. One was a fellow named Barr McClellan, who was Johnson's attorney for 15 years. The book is Blood, Money, and Power. And there's another fellow whose name I don't
Roger
recall.
Roger Stone is one.
Yeah, Roger Stone is one. Okay, could somebody clarify that? Why all of a sudden is mainstream media giving some attention to somebody saying that Lyndon Johnson was behind?
I'm writing a book on Mack Wallace and Lyndon Johnson, so I'm going to answer this one a little bit myself.
Yeah.
Because we've got to, and I also, and I telling everyone, I reinvestigated the question of whether that fingerprint up there on the sixth floor, the unidentified fingerprint that was in the hands of the Warren Commission, was in fact Mack Wallace's. And I just can tell you why I keep this. Jim Garrison always used to say, and he was referring to Bobby Kennedy, when you know something, say it. Don't hold it back, because something bad could happen to you. If you'll be, it's very dangerous to you if you don't tell. If once you say what you know, then you're no danger anymore. So I don't think that I'm in a great danger. But in any case, I did a reinvestigation of the fingerprint using a certified latent print examiner who was an officer in the certifying organization which originally certified Nathan Darby and Hugh and Hoffmeister, the two people that were used to say that Mack Wallace, that was Mack Wallace's fingerprint, with the implication that somehow Lyndon Johnson was involved, since Mack Wallace by himself certainly had no motivation to get involved with killing. He was a liberal and he would never have killed President Kennedy. It had to be because he was doing it for Lyndon Johnson. And what I found out, one number one, was that Nathan Darby was not certified when he signed the affidavit saying that that was Mack Wallace's print, that he wasn't certified at the time, and that there was a letter in his file which said that he would never be certified again should he apply for recertification. In any case, if anyone wants to do this, don't rely on me and my certified latent, although he was an officer in this thing. Go do it. You can get the photograph of the unidentified print at the National Archives. The FBI did a fabulous print. It's that crystal clear. And all hundreds of shades of gray, whatever, go look. You can get it free, practically. And look at it yourself. Look at the Navy prints, because Mack Wallace was in the U.S. Marines, and the Navy did fabulous prints. Never under these people, they're not nothing. And the Navy prints are so clear as a bell. And the Austin prints are less good, but the first thing that the certified print examiner did with me, looked at the Navy and he looked at Austin, because Mack Wallace had committed a murder in Austin and they had his prints. And he said, these are the same guy.
Joe,
and then, wait a minute, okay. I'm not done.
Okay.
Just a minute.
Okay.
And then he looked at the Warren Commission print, and that was not the same guy. But I want to say the real question that John asked, it's a real question, why the sudden flurry of books in the last decade saying that Lyndon Johnson did it? I see this as a form of undermining Jim Garrison again, because what happened? How do you undermine Jim Garrison? The first way they did it was to say that the Mafia did it, Carlos Marcello and his brothers and the whole group, and they did it. Now that lasted for several years, quite a few years we had books like that. So that got tired out. How about an alternate sponsor? How about some story which CIA does not get involved in? If you look at those books, you will not find any discussion of CIA involvement with Oswald or with the Kennedy assassination. Strictly Lyndon Johnson, and as Tom Bowden said, who ran the Conspiracy Museum in Dealey Plaza, a Texas story. This is Texas justice. This has nothing to do with anybody else. So
Easy scapegoat to, you know, the guy wants to become president, so he's going to take out the guy who's at, you know, it avoids the difficult question of if the CIA was really involved.
Why
should it be one or the other? How about all of them?
No, they say that. These people are saying it's only Lyndon Johnson. We're not saying
Michael,
it.
We have a young man in the audience who wants to ask a question. Is he still there?
Is that that young student from?
I moved over here. Right.
Where are you?
Oh, back there.
Okay, go ahead.
Hi, my name's Aaron, so forgive me, I'm only 18, I'm a high school student, so my question may not be the most intelligent, so forgive me. But what I want to know is, I do believe that the CIA was involved. I do believe they had Kennedy assassinated. But why assassinate him in broad daylight with thousands, for the sake of argument, let's say thousands of witnesses saying that they saw shooters in the grassy knoll, and then have to go through all the work of having to cover it up?
Very simple. The same reason we execute publicly criminals, to serve as a deterrent to anyone that would try to follow in his footsteps and knock down the war machine and put us on a path to peace and prosperity and not let the bankers run the country. Okay? They had to, and at the time, you're too young to remember this, but at the time, all the talk was the Kennedy dynasty. Mm-hmm. Right? You got Jack, and then you got Robert, and then you got Edward, and they're all in line. And for the enemies of the Kennedys, it's like, holy cow, we're going to have a Kennedy in the White House for the next 20 years, you know. So they had to kill him in broad daylight. It was a public execution to serve as a deterrent. And while I'm at it, let me point out that Kennedy, in the summer of 63, became only the second U.S. president to try to issue money through the Treasury, not through the banking system of the Federal Reserve. Okay, and the first president that tried to do that was Abraham Lincoln, who issued greenbacks instead of borrowing money from the international bankers to finance the war between the states. And folks, I don't think it was just a coincidence that those two presidents were shot in the head in public.
It was Executive Order 11110. And the day that he was shot, they stopped printing those.
Kennedy was the last president who thought he could take power. Everybody after, as Jim said, they know that they have that gun at their heads. They know they better not try to do anything, take any decisions on their own.
In fact, if you remember your history, the first assassination attempt on a U.S. president was Andrew Jackson back in, what, about 1832, something like that. And what was he doing? He was trying to get away from the bankers.
National Bank.
In fact, he ended the central bank.
George Bush always denied that he was in Dallas, or he couldn't remember where he was, but we saw from one of these documents that Garrison gave us that evidently the FBI got, or CIA got some kind of report from George Bush warning about an assassination attempt. Do you think Bush in any way knew about this? Knew it was going to happen?
I think so. And by the way, what you mentioned there was the case of James Parrott.
Yes.
Let me point this out. Bush did two things by the day after the assassination, reporting to the FBI that James Parrott of Houston might have been involved in plotting against the... James Parrott, I met him. He's a really nice, quiet, milquetoast guy. He was the head of the fledgling Young Republicans at that time in Texas. Keep in mind, at the time of the assassination, there were no Republicans in Texas. It was old yellow dog Democrats, okay? John Tower had become the first Republican elected since the war. James Parrott, though, detested Lyndon Johnson, and also Bush. So he was a thorn in Bush's side in the Young Republicans there in Texas. And so this is the guy. So he reports him to the FBI. They made James Parrott's life miserable. And, of course, he could never pin anything on him. But it got rid of a political enemy of George Herbert Walker Bush.
The other document that you didn't have in the film, but we know, is that supposed one where Hoover says that he debriefed right after the assassination George Bush of the CIA.
Yeah.
Where Hoover's obviously outing Bush. Yeah. Bush has been a long-time CIA. There's no question about that. And it looks like internal warfare here between the FBI and CIA.
Okay, and anyway, I want to thank you all so much for being here.
We could
literally go on forever. And I'm sure we will, because this will not be the last word. But saying goodnight, I would like Dick and Joan and Jim to take 1.5 minutes to sum up what it is that you want to sum up, to say goodnight to the people.
You go first. Yeah, go ahead.
Well, just that I feel this was a very important night, that the Garrison film that John worked on has finally been shown to actually a worldwide audience on the web. And it's vitally important for the future of our kids and grandkids in the country, because they're up against so much in terms of civil liberties and climate change and just unbelievable obstacles they're going to face, that we pass on to them. There's not too many young people here tonight. That it's vitally important to understand what happened 50 years ago and through the other assassinations in the 60s. That's really all I've got to say, is that I still feel it's vitally important to get to the truth, if we can, about what happened, and so that the country can move on from a place that really never has.
I think we got to the truth. We didn't get to the justice. Joan?
Well, I would like to underline what Dick said, and that is that what we're looking at here is Garrison suggesting to us that something has changed about our country. CIA has taken a role in power that it was not meant to have. And if I could take 1 second, if somebody wants to study the story of the history of CIA, I call your attention to an article in the Virginia Historical Review of 1946 by Ambassador David K. E. Bruce, warning against the creation of CIA and saying that be careful, because this could well become an American Gestapo. And David Bruce then, for under President Eisenhower, wrote, talked about this before, the Bruce Lovett Report, in which he describes the murders and mayhem created by the clandestine services. Alan Dulles was the creator of CIA behind the scenes, and somebody like Bruce, who is a great American patriot, and by the way, John also has reintroduced us to the idea of a liberal. Jim Garrison was truly a classical liberal. He's not a Marxist. Alan Dulles is a was a very, as we look at his history, an anti-Semite and a person who collaborated with the Galen organization. Some people have asked that question on the emails, and asked the Galens to take over the United States intelligence efforts in the Soviet Union after the war. And he relied on all the Nazi SS and Galen organization, which was the Nazi intelligence, to do that. There's so many subjects. We're not done. We're done tonight, maybe, but we're not done. Jim.
Oh, okay. All right, well, I want to give you some ammunition to take away with you tonight. So when it comes up about the assassination, here's the basics. If you have unlimited faith and confidence in the federal government of the United States, then you believe the evidence that they present to you in this case. And I will be the first to admit that taken at that level, it's pretty incriminating against Lee Harvey Oswald. But if you have the slightest suspicions and the slightest doubt about the faith and veracity of the federal government, and let's see now, light at the end of the tunnel in Vietnam, I am not a crook, read my lips, no new taxes, weapons of mass destruction. I didn't have sex with that woman.
You can keep your doctor.
And if you like your health care plan, you can keep your health care plan. All right, will they lie to us? Only continuously. So then, once you begin to think for yourself and quit listening to the CIA-backed corporate mass media, then you'll start figuring out and you'll know the truth about the Kennedy assassination. Maybe not every detail.
Ladies and gentlemen, the fact that I could do this live webcast, even though I had to pay for it, proves that we still live in the most interesting country in the world. And perhaps it would be a much more interesting country and a much more humane society if we cared as much about who killed our president as who's going to get killed Sunday in the Super Bowl. But when it comes to the Super Bowls of assassinations, the first one being November 22, 1963, the score was the government won, the truth nothing. But we all know the truth won because the officials were corrupt. The truth will never get its trophy or its true justice until those officials who still hold high office and their clones who still hold high office are removed from that high office. But because when it comes to political assassinations, which are still continuing, they're still calling